Good morning, Saints. How are you doing today? Well, here it is, a chilly Tuesday morning, and we got food bank going on, and I know that they would appreciate any and all help that you can come down and give them. And looking forward to a great time out there, and looking forward to this Bible study right now that we're involved in, because, you know, we're talking about the book of James, and James has all to do with the practical Christian life. And we titled it Christianity in Shoe Leather. You know, this is the way we're to live. And boy, today he really just hammers a nail home into our hearts and minds and gives us some things to think about. And man, he just shares with us some great truths. In James chapter 4, verse number 1, we see these words: from whence come wars, fightings among you? Come they not hence even of your lust that war in your members? Wow. He's talking about the arguments, the quarrels, the strife that we go through, the times that we have where we quit being the peacemakers and we put on our warring mask and we go after each other, whether in the home or the job or in the ministry, the attack and tear people down. And you know, there's a way this thing escalates. It starts off where we begin to attack with our words, and then as we begin to attack with our words, the words become more and more fierce. We begin to attack personalities, and after we begin to attack personalities, we turn that from that to attacking relationships. Why, you know, and cause that division in our marriages or in our churches or in our jobs, and you know, it just becomes a self defeating situation we put ourselves in. We got to be very careful. And not only that, it even escalates to the point to where we even go to war and kill each other. And that's what happens. And that's what he's saying. Where do all these wars and fightings come from? He says, I want to tell you where they come from. He says, it comes from your lust. Now, when he says the word lust here, we have to get the right definition of the word lust, or else we're going to be in trouble, because it's not like lusting after, you know, chocolate cake, or even a lust of somebody who may have a problem with pornography. I think so many times when we talk about the word lust, we kind of just leave it in one area of life and we never really understand what it truly means. But what he's talking about here is that covetousness that we have, that self-centeredness, where we're trying to impose our will, where we want our way, where we are selfish in our thinking. He says, when you and I get to the place in our lives to where we are selfish and all we care about is our own wants, well, you better watch out. We're a hurricane in the making. And soon we are going to be at war, because there's actually a war going on inside of us. He says this, not only does it kind of hurt our friendships and our relationships, but in verse number 2, look what he says here. You lust and have not, you kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. You fight and war, yet ye have not because you ask not. He says, man, you do all this stuff to get what you think is going to make you happy, and you find out that when you get to the end of it all, it doesn't make you happy. You may still kill and destroy. You say, preacher, I don't still kill and destroy. Well, you get so involved in a job that you forget your family. You get so in pursuit of something in life that other things just fall by the wayside. And James has come along here and says, listen, I'm going to tell you something. All that we do to gain, all it makes us do is want more. He says, be careful, because when your lust or those cravings or those desires or that selfishness becomes the guiding instrument in your life, when it becomes the guiding force that is causing you to live your life, you better watch out. You're headed for trouble. And then to close it all up in this short little passage right here in verse number 3, he says, your own cravings, your own lust, your own desires, your own covetousness, your own selfishness even hinders your prayers. Look what he says here. You ask and you receive not, because you ask amiss that you may consume it upon your lust. He says, you ask and receive not. Now, God wants to bless us. God wants to give us good gifts, and all good gifts do come from the Father. But sometimes you and I, we ask based on our lust, our desires, our covetousness. And we need to be very careful that when we ask, he says that you ask amiss. Well, that's wrongly. That word amiss means to ask for something wrongly. He says, you're asking God for things so that you consume your lust upon it. And you know what? And you realize that your whole prayer life is about me, rather than about others and the will of God. And coming to the place to where you and I become a channel of blessings to others through not only our giving, but through our prayer life, where God uses us. And James comes along here and says to the church and to each one of us here, you better be careful. You better get this thing about cravings and desires and selfishness. And he calls it all lust. He says, you better get control of that, because when that gets control of you, you're a train wreck. And all who are involved in your life are going to somewhat experience that train wreck with you. And so he comes along here and he tells us to listen, back off, be careful. You know, it's amazing, because whenever you get to James chapter 3, which we were in yesterday, he explains the false wisdom and how that false wisdom leads to disorder, how it leads to evil, how it leads to all kinds of confusion. We talked about it yesterday. And he says that the true wisdom has wonderful results. And then chapter 4 starts, and it's as if he's picking up on those very same things. And he's telling you, listen, the wisdom of this world is based on lust. Our lust comes out of the wisdom of this world that seeks self-gratification. Oh, but the wisdom that's from above, that comes from God, is the wisdom that wants to help and to be a blessing to all those around them. And then he comes right here in this chapter, and he begins to write these words right here in these first three verses. And boy, oh boy, what a powerful truth he gives us right here as he opens this chapter. Now, this chapter, we're going to divide it up a little bit. I realize we start with these first two questions here, and I believe what he's doing in these first two questions here is he is challenging us to realize the truth. And that truth is this, that unchallenged evil will never go away. Please get this truth. I don't know, maybe I should have put it on the screen so you could see it and maybe it'd sink into your head, but here's the deal. Unchallenged evil will never go away. You say, what are you saying, preacher? I'm saying, here's the deal. The evil that we have, our sinful habits, our lustful desires, will never go away if you and I never fight and challenge them. And we must challenge them with the truth and the Word of God. We must stand against the evil, not only in society, but in our own hearts and minds, if we're going to be successful for the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what James is teaching us here in these first three verses. Get control of your desires. Let your desires be the things of God, and it'll make you a better Christian for the journey. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love you and thank you for your mercy and your grace. We thank you for your word. Father, we pray through that amazing grace that we have been given from you, Lord, that we would learn, each of us, to challenge, Lord, the evil that's in our lives, that, Lord, we may be the successful Christians you want us to be. Father, forgive us of our sins. And Lord, give us the courage to even fight ourselves, that we may gain the victory for the Lord Jesus Christ. For we pray in Jesus' name, amen. All right, there you go. Go serve your King. Bye-bye.